Hey everybody, welcome to Board Game Heaven. Today I'm going to talk about Jim Henson's Labyrinth the Boardgame by River Horse. I'll show you what you get in the box and talk about its components. I'll explain the rules and on the end I'll tell you what I thought about the game. So let's get started with Jim Henson's Labyrinth the Boardgame.
Okay, let's have a look at the box. So the box itself, I already cut off the shrink wrap from the back. But it has a nice picture of the game in play with all the components, a little bit of flavor text and all the components, which is standard for most board games. It's for ages 6 and up, plays 1 to 5 it says, but I find it's basically 1 to 4. Because if there's a fifth player, he plays Jareth, and he doesn't really have a lot to do, but you'll see. And it plays in about 30 minutes. Right, so what do you get? Let's see. The box has a nice transparent cover, so you can see your nice miniatures here, and if you paint them, that'll be even better, you know. And the miniatures are, of course, the highlight of this game. Now, I have to tell you, if you haven't seen this movie, go see the movie. It's great, it's fantastic. If you've grown up in the 80s like me, and you must have seen this movie. And this, for me, was really an instant buy simply because of nostalgia. I really like the movie. I'm a big fan of David Bowie. And, so that really did it for me. But let's have a look at the components first before we go into the actual game. So here's your Ludo miniature. Very detailed. And he's the biggest one of them all, of course. So that's pretty cool. Here's Sir Didymus. The tiny dog astride another dog. It's a very funny character in the movie. And, you know, the movie being a Jim Henson production has lots of Muppets. People playing with Muppets. It's just, it's great fun. So here's Jareth, played by David Bowie in the movie. The Goblin King. And there's Sarah, the heroine of the movie. Who's going to save her baby brother, Toby, from the clutches of Jareth. And Hoggle, finally, who comes to aid Sarah. And they're very nicely detailed. I really like how they look. They're exactly like in the movie. So that's them. Then you have some plastic standees, which are used for the final battles, the final bosses, and they're standees, so they are on the cardboard, which is underneath this. You get the character boards, so all players have their own board with their statistics on them. Let's have a look at them. Some very nice printed, you know, the logo, the Labyrinth logo on them, each in its own color. So four of these, here's Hoggle, and he has these stats here, all of them have, and it tells you which dice to roll, or which die to roll for each statistic. So he rolls a d6 for speed, a d12 for wit, and a d8 for brawn, and he starts with 3 willpower. And when you lose willpower, you need to go to the oubliette. So I'll explain that later, but the more willpower, the more beatings you can take. So that's Hoggle. Sir Didymus has some more willpower, is faster, less wit, and more brawn. Here's Ludo, who's not very fast, but he's at least faster than Hoggle. He's not very smart, but he's strong. A lot of brawn, a lot of willpower. Sarah is relatively fast, smart, but isn't very strong, but has a lot of willpower. So that's the four characters you have, and they're, you know, the color is a nice representative image if you're gonna paint them. Okay, so then there's the dice, of course, as you saw on the character sheets. You have these colored dice. So each type of die has its own color, makes them easy to recognize. So each of these, and the D20 is mostly used for Jareth. So, you know, nice, easy to recognize. And then there's a deck of cards. Now each character has a special ability card, and the rest are labyrinth cards. So that's basically the stuff that you're gonna have to face. So it has a lot of references to the movie, a lot of quotes. So these are the four character cards that you get. So each character starts out with these, and you can use them once during the game. And the rest are all these final battles, I think. Yep. And what's this? Oh yeah, these are also character cards, and these, the ones I showed you further before, are basically buffs. They help you. And these are weakness cards. So if you want to make the game more challenging, you also give them these weakness cards. It's kind of like a curse that you can break, and there's a certain condition on this, and if you meet that condition, you can discard this card and be free of that negative condition. Okay, so here's all these lilac cards. These are your labyrinth cards, and you shuffle those, and there's a entrance to the labyrinth here somewhere. I don't know if it's green one. Let me just quickly go through these. Oh, here, entrance to Goblin City. So this is the card that you're gonna draw somewhere near the end of the game, and it takes you to the entrance of the Goblin City, of course, where you have to battle these special monsters. So you go through these first, and then finally they're numbered, so you have them in the right order. So I think they go in backward order, though, because Humongous is, I think, the last one. Although, is that the first one you encounter? Could be. I'm not sure. I'll have to look it up in the rules. But you face Humongous, the big mechanical golem that is embedded in the door, and when it closes, he kind of joins halves and he steps out. It's really cool in the movie. There's goblin infantry and the goblin cavalry riding these funny creatures, and the goblin artillery, which is basically a walking turret. Probably there's a goblin in there somewhere. Then there's the goblin king's maze. So you just need to test your wit against the D20, and then you recite the spell that's in the rules, and then you win the game. And oh yeah, here's the spell. So you can just recite this. It's basically some fluff, just stuff from the movie. But this is the final bits that you need to overcome to win the game. And then underneath this, it has a nice thumb hole here, so you can easily take out the insert, which is nice and felty. There's a pamphlet for an expansion that has goblins, so yeah, I'm gonna have to see if I can find that, because, you know, more of these cool miniatures. Very, very nice. Some other games they've made. The rulebook, of course, and it's rather thin, because this is an easy game to learn. It's very simple, but so that's easy to learn. Some nice pictures from the movie. Some rules for 1, 2, or 3 players on 5, because this is basically made for 4 players. And then the punch boards, Now, first you'll notice this big clock, and that's to keep track of time during the game, because you've got 13 hours, so basically 13 turns to go to the Goblin City and beat the final challenges. Otherwise, you lose. These are your willpower tokens, and this is a smell bad token that you get when you fall into the bog of eternal stench. So they're two-sided except for the clock. And here is the more willpower tokens, because you'll need several of these. And the final bosses. This is the first player marker. There's a little Toby over here, surrounded by the goblins, these Muppets. Does it focus? Yeah, there he goes. And the rest are the goblin artillery and the cavalry and the infantry and Humongous over here. And those go on these plastic bases, as you've seen. So that's what you get in the game. And of course, finally, the board. Now let me show you this board. This is, I really like this board. It's rather busy, I have to warn you, but it is really reminiscent of the movie, which of course it should be. Oh no, I'm already breaking my board. Okay, let me just see. Right. So as you can see, there's a lot going on here. And, well, this is the Goblin City. I like the artwork on this. It has scenes from the movie, all the places and all the characters that you saw. And, well, it's just, there's a lot to take in. But really, the board isn't much more than a circle, because you're going to be moving around these white spaces, and cards are going to be dealt here. And you can move in both directions until you find that entrance to the Goblin City card, which takes you here to the gate. And there you face these five challenges, and hopefully you win. There's four spaces on the edges. Here is the Oubliette. Here is the Bog of Eternal Stench. Here is the entrance to the Labyrinth, where Hoggle starts. And there's well, another part of the labyrinth. I think Ludo starts here, Sir Didymus starts here, Hoggle, and Sarah starts here, and of course Jareth starts in the middle. So let's quickly set up the game and explain the rules. So here's the game set up. Like I said, Jareth starts in the Goblin City. Sir Didymus starts over there in the Bog of Eternal Stench. Ludo starts over there. Sarah, who's been wandering around in the maze and has lost all hope and all willpower, has fallen into the Oubliette, so that's where she starts. And Hoggle is here at the entrance, spraying fairies, like in the movie. So that's where your four characters start, and you just simply decide which player controls who. If you're four players, each has one. If you're three players, one player has Ludo and Sir Didymus, and the other two have these two. And if you're one player, you control them all, and if you're two players, you simply decide which two you want to play. That's basically it. And if you're playing five players, then one player controls Jareth, and all he really does is roll the dice for the bad guys. And every time a character lands on an empty space and a card needs to be drawn, then he can draw two cards, decide which one to play, and then play that card. So yeah, there's not a whole lot to do if you're playing Jareth, but okay, it's a possibility. So you've set up the board, placed your characters, each character has gotten their character card with their stats on them, their starting willpower tokens, and their bonus cards, and if you want to, their weakness cards as well. You put the clock over here and it starts at 13 because the first hour is going to be 1. And those tokens for the end bosses you just put on the side for now. So you've got your first player token, or basically it's your turn token, and Hoggle always starts. So Hoggle gets this card first. So then you take these labyrinth cards, the pink ones, or the lilac ones. You take out the entrance to the Goblin City, you put that apart for now. So you shuffle all these cards, shuffle them, And then the rule book says to take out one card, don't look at it, just put it away. Don't use it in this game. That way each game will be slightly different. Okay, fine. Then you take 10 cards, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, put them aside. You shuffle these, there. You take those 10 cards, you take the entrance to the Goblin City, you stick it in, you shuffle those as well. So the entrance is going to be in the last 10 cards somewhere. And you put these on top, and this is your Labyrinth deck. Every time a card needs to be discarded, then you place it at the bottom of the deck so you don't easily see when you're near the end. So that's the whole setup of the game. Let's get started. Okay, so what can you do during your turn? There's only two things to do. That's either resting or moving. Now, whenever you rest, you can do a test to get a willpower token. So what you do is you take the blue, the green D6, you roll it. If you roll lower than a 4, you don't get a willpower token. If you roll a 4, 5, or a 6, then you can take a willpower token from the stack and add it to your total. Now, you can never have more than 6, though, because as you can see on the cards, all of these cards have 6 willpower icons, and the colored in is, of course, the amount you start with, but you can never have more than 6. And when you move, you just check your card and you check your speed die. You take that card die and you roll it. Then you decide which way to go. You can either go left or right, but you need to go the amount of spaces that you roll. So in this case, Hoggle would need to move 6 spaces. So we can just check where we're gonna end. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That would land me in the oubliette. Now, whenever you land in the oubliette, you need to lie down because you've fallen asleep, you're down on your luck, you feel depressed, and that does give you the opportunity to rest on your next go, and you automatically get a willpower token. You don't have to roll for that when you're in the oubliette. So that's a plus, that's a positive thing. So let's see where we go on the other side. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So let's go that way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm over here. So that spot is empty now. So I have to draw a labyrinth card. And then you read and you see what it does. So this one says fairies, the nasty little things that Hoggle has been spraying at the entrance of the labyrinth. And it says test your brawn versus one red die. All right, so Hoggle's brawn is a yellow die, so that's D8. So he takes his D8, he rolls, and he only rolls a 2. So I have to test that against a red die. Unfortunately, fairies aren't very strong. So that's a 50% chance. Let's see what happens. A 4. So Hoggle gets beaten by the fairies. When that happens, you just look at the card. And if there's a success in this case, leave this card on the space. And if there's a failure, it says lose 1 willpower and leave this card on the space. So you basically just do what the card does. So I've lost. I put this card down. I lose a willpower token. And that is it. Okay, so now it's Sir Didymus' turn. His speed is the black die, it's a d12. So he rolls his die, he rolls a 12. Now let's say for this example's sake that he rolled a 1. Now he could move there, but he can also choose to move here and land on the same space as Hoggle. He'd have to resolve his test of this card, so we'd have to roll his brawn. Is it brawn? Yes, it's brawn. It's purple die. So I'm rolling this. I'm rolling a 6. He automatically wins because the fairies only have the d4. So he wins, and the card is, you know, left on that space. It's what it says. So nothing happens, but they can team up. Now, after Ludo and Sour have taken their turns, and it's Hoggle's turn again, he can choose to bring Sir Didymus along. So first, he's going to say, okay, do do you want to come with me or not? And then the player with Sardinimus can say, yeah, sure, let's go together, or decline. And then you roll as a group. But now it is Hoggle's turn, and he would normally roll this, so that's it seems going to happen. If it was Sardinimus' turn, though, and he would be the person moving, he'd still have to roll the green die, because that's Hoggle's speed die. And if you're moving as a group, you have to adjust to the slowest person. So you always roll the slowest person's die for your movement as a group. So, okay, now this was Hoggle's turn, so he rolls a 5, and Sardinimus decided to tag along before he rolled. So you've got 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's go that way. So you land there, there's no card, draw a card. Oh look, it's a goblin. So that's a test brawn versus one red die. Very simple, discard this card if you succeed, or lose a willpower token and leave this card on the space. Now, if you're testing as a group, which is the benefit of going together, then you both roll your brawn die in this case. So, okay, versus a red die. So the goblin isn't very strong, so I'm going to roll that. So that's 2. Now, Hoggle's brawn is the yellow die, so that's 6. He wins. You don't even need to roll this, but I will. And that's a 5. Now, you don't add those up, but you check the highest result. And that's the result, in this case, the 6, that takes up the challenge and versus a 2. So the group wins. It's the same with a wit test. If you draw a card that has a wit challenge instead of brawn, that's the same. You take your wit die, you roll it, highest result scores against the bad guy's roll. But if you have a speed test, then again, just like with moving, you take the lowest person's speed die and roll that, so you don't get to choose. Okay, so in this case, we won. And I get to discard this, so I put this back on the bottom of the Labyrinth deck and put that back. Now, there's another thing that I need to mention, and that is when we've discussed the oubliette. So when you end your turn on the oubliette, you have to lie your character down, indicating that he or she is sleeping, and on that character's next turn, you have to spend a turn resting to set your character back up again, but you get your willpower token. And you can choose to rest on any other turn instead of moving, and you just put your character down again. Or actually, you don't need to, you just say that you're resting, you roll this die, and then you take a willpower token if you roll 4 or higher. But the opposite of the oubliette here on the other side of the board is the Bog of Eternal Stench. If you land there, you also don't draw a card, because it's indicated that this is square, doesn't fit a card. And instead, you have to do a test. Now, you take your speed die, and if you're as a group, then it's again the lowest speed die. And then you roll it, and on a 1 or a 2, you slip and you fall into the Bog of Eternal Stench. And that's a bad thing, because you get a smell bad token, and that's gonna affect your social abilities, as you might have guessed. And if you have that token, you just put it on your card, and then the next time that someone wants to bring you along as a group, so say Hoggle here wants to take Sardinimus, but Sardinimus is very smelly, then he'll have to, before he rolls his movement, he'll have to ask, okay, are you coming along with me? Well, Sardinimus is very ashamed that he's smelling so bad, so he's going to have to roll a test as well. So what you do is you take the green die, it's always the green die, you roll it on a 1 or a 2, I think, or was it 1 or 2? No, it's a 4 or more, I'm sorry. So 1, 2 or 3 means you're so embarrassed of your smelliness that you have to decline the invitation to move along with the rest of the group. And on a 4 or more, of course, you can just freely come along, but it's going to stay with you for the rest of the game. So it's a bad thing. Also, you cannot rest in the bog of eternal stench because it's just too smelly. You really don't want to stay there. Okay, so let's quickly continue for a bit. It's Ludo's go. I should have given him the token. He takes his speed die. He rolls it. He rolls a 3. 1, 2, 3. So I can't join the rest, but I'm going to go the other way. I'm going to go here. 1, 2, 3. Okay, there is Ludo. He's on an empty spot. He draws a card. And there is a goblin mob. Choose to trick them. Test wit versus 1 green die. Or face them. Test brawn versus 1 green die. And 1 yellow die. So, okay, Ludo's brawn is pretty high because he's a big, strong beast. So he's got a d12. And the green and yellow dice are the d6 and the d8. So I think I'm going to go with that because my wit is just a d6. So that would be an equal challenge. And I like the odds of my black die here. So Ludo rolls his brawn. And he rolls a 7. So that's very good. I take these two for the bad guy, for the goblin mob in this case. And I roll a 1 and a 3. And the highest result counts, so that's the 3. 3 versus 7, the goblin mob loses. And when I succeed, I discard this card. So that goes back to the bottom of the labyrinth deck. So, okay, next person. Yeah, let me just get that. Okay, now it's finally Sarah's turn. Sarah's speed is a purple die. Roll that, I roll 2. So I'm going to try and join up with Ludo. So I'm going to move here. Draw a card. More goblins, what a surprise. Test brawn versus 1 green and 1 red die. And well, that's bad news because Sarah is not very strong. But okay, we'll just try. Neither are goblins, fortunately. So a green and a red die. That's a 2 and a 2, so it's always going to be 2. I take my green die for Sarah, which she just can't see, but it's over there. She has a green brawn die, and she rolls a 2. Now it's a tie. What happens on a tie? Well, that's very simple. On a tie, you win. Woo! So we were successful, and we discard this card. So that's good. Doing well so far. So next up is Hoggle again. This doesn't happen, that was just an example, so okay. Hoggle's turn, Hoggle's speed. He's gonna ask Sir Didymus to tag along. Sir Didymus says, yeah, sure, let's go. And we roll a 1. Well, that's not very much, but okay, we'll just move here. Oh, I forgot though, after Sarah's turn, Jareth's turn was up, so the clock moves 1 hour because we spent an hour doing things. Okay, so now, he rolled a 1. I've moved. I'm gonna draw a card. So here's the junkyard. Okay, test your wit versus 1 purple die. And that's it. So the wit, let's see, we've got a yellow and a black wit die. That's pretty nice. Oh, look, a 12. And I have to, yeah, against a d10, you're always gonna win. So we win this card, and when we succeed, we leave this card on this spot. So that goes there. Great. Okay, so you get the point. This goes on and on. It's basically, it's moving and dice rolling, moving and dice rolling, and you could decide to rest at some point and gain willpower tokens. And you can also rest as a group. When you're resting as a group, well, basically the person whose turn it is, He or she rolls the green die, except when you're in the Obliad, you just automatically get your willpower token. And after you've either succeeded and received the willpower token or not, then all the characters in the group can choose to share their willpower token. So if one person in your group is running out and you've got plenty, you could pass on a willpower or more token if you wish. Now, sleeping characters cannot hand out or receive willpower tokens. A sleeping character cannot decide to join a group. Also, a sleeping character, when in battle, when doing a test, cannot join into the battle, so you can't use the die of that person that's sleeping. but also doesn't get the negative effects. So if you lose and everybody needs to lose willpower, that doesn't happen to the sleeping player because that person just sleeps through it all. There are cards in the Labyrinth deck that actually make you fall asleep, so that can happen. Something else you can do is when you've lost a test, you can spend a willpower token to take the blue die, the d20, and roll that instead. So if you've lost and you're you know about to lose your last willpower token, or you just need to win that, you can do that and then roll this and then see if you've rolled better. So okay, in the deck there is also a couple of cards like the worm or the wise man with the hat that you can keep. If you draw this, you keep this card and it lets you roll a blue die as well. So this is basically a free re-roll of the blue die without spending a willpower token. And there are also some Jareth cards in here. And so for example here it says Jareth appears and you take Jareth and he appears at the spot where the card is drawn. And then you need to do a test, and it's basically the same as all the other cards, so something happens on a success or on a fail. And there's a very funny one in here, that's this one, the magic dance, where you have to recite this bit of text from the movie, and you need to know it by heart. So the person playing the bad guy, or the person actually playing Jareth, takes this card and starts reading the sentence with a J. And the other person has to, you know, reply with the, but it's pretty simple, because all you need to say is what babe, what power, who do, and do what. So yeah, you can remember that. But if you've seen the movie, you'll probably know this. But that's just, all of these cards are, you know, just funny reminders of the movie. You've got the Fiery's Camp, the Peach, the Goblin Knight, we've seen that. So okay, at some point you're gonna draw the entrance to the Goblin City. So let's say Sarah moves here, draws that card, and you place it there. And then this spot is basically the gateway to this spot. And when that happens, you place your big standees on these places, or your humongous standee goes there, like is indicated by these cards. And I was just thinking, they could have basically just gone without these cards, because they're double-sided, they're basically the same, just tell you where they go, but they could have printed it on these cards. I mean, these are big standees. They could have just put, you know, the number one here and put the test here. So they're all drawn tests, all of them. And just put the dice here. Okay, just a random thought I had. So on spot one, you put Humongous. On spot two, the Goblin Infantry. That's these guys. The Infantry, then the Cavalry, if I'm not mistaken, and then the Artillery. And finally, there, that's where Jareth goes into the Escher-like maze with all the stairs, which is an awesome scene from the movie. So yeah, and you have to do this wit test, but only Sarah can do that. So once you've beaten all these four as a group, preferably, then Sarah needs to move here with Jareth, and only she can do the wit test. And if she wins that, then she can recite this spell and you win the game. That's the whole game. These are just, all of them are like I said, brawn tests. And the first one is the blue die. Then you've got a combination of red, green, and yellow, and highest count wins. Again, green, yellow, and purple. Yellow, purple, and black. So it gets a little bit tougher each time. But if you're as a group, you can roll all your brawn dice. So if you've got Ludo with you, you've got a good chance of winning. And you can still spend willpower tokens to roll the blue die. Or if you have one of those cards that lets you re-roll with a blue die, you can use that. And you can also use your strength cards And this is also really the same. So just roll a blue die if you fail a test. So it might be handy to try and hold on to these for as long as you can. Each character has one of those. And like I said, you've also got the weakness cards if you want to make it more challenging. And this just says what it does. So this character says, use a purple die for your wit instead of the black one until you win a wit test. And you can discard this, and then you feel smarter and you get to use your regular die. And all the characters have one of these. Right, so what do I think of the game? Well, obviously, having seen the movie as a kid myself, I loved the movie, so I really, really like this game. I like the way it looks, I like the art, I like all the pictures, the scenes from the movie, I love the miniatures, and on the other side, it's a very, very simple game. Now, that's a positive thing in that you can teach it easily and quickly, and you can learn it simply playing it. I mean, you don't even need to explain a whole lot. But the downside is, of course, that it's a luck fest. You get to roll a lot of dice, and you either win or lose, and you've got some margin with your willpower tokens, so you can use the blue die. But that's basically it. This really is a very light gateway family game that's great with younger people, and with, you know, if you've got kids, this is fantastic, and you've got a good excuse to watch the movie again. And so in that regard, this is fun, but it's not a very challenging game. I mean, it's challenging to reach the Goblin City. It's not easy to beat the game, but that's simply because a lot of this depends on luck. So this is probably not a game that once you've played it, people are gonna say, yeah, let's do that again and see if we can beat him this time. This is a one-time game on an evening, and you'll say, okay, this was fun, let's move on and play something else. Doesn't mean it's a bad game. It's just a very light and simple game. If you like the movie, you're probably gonna like this. If you have nothing in common with the movie, if you haven't seen it, if you don't care for it, if you've got no clue what it's about, this game will probably bore you. And that's just what it is. But, you know, just that's my opinion. All in all, I give it a thumbs up because I like it, and it's a light game. You can play with just about anyone, and it's fun. It's just plain, simple fun, and that's what a game should be.
Well, that was Jim Henson's Labyrinth board game. I hope you enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe and see you next time on Board Game Heaven.